Hello everyone, we have seen the generic nature of frequency response of an amplifier. Now this response has two parts, the low frequency response. This is controlled by the external capacitors in the amplifier, and the high frequency response, which is controlled by internal capacitances of the MOSFET. The value of FL, that is a lower 3 dB frequency, or in terms of radians per second, it is called as the omega H, can be calculated by the method called as the short circuit time constant method. High frequency response, as has been defined by the internal capacitances, and the corresponding 3 dB frequency is called as FH or omega H. This will be decided by the internal components of the MOSFET, internal capacitances of the MOSFET. So bandwidth is equal to FH minus FL or omega H minus omega L. In case of integrated circuit amplifiers, external capacitances are not generally used. So FL is equal to 0 or omega L is equal to 0, and we get bandwidth as only FH or omega H. There are various methods available to find out the higher 3 dB frequency. We have seen Miller multiplication method, but there are certain disadvantages of Miller multiplication method. The first important problem with Miller multiplication is that we will not be able to decide which pole is dominant if the load capacitance CL is connected at the output of amplifier. That load capacitor might be the input capacitance of the next stage. Also, in certain complex amplifier circuits, it is difficult to use the Miller's multiplication method. So we are going to see another method here, which is called as open circuit time constant method, to find out the higher 3 dB frequency omega H. Now, if we consider any amplifier, of course, we are interested in the frequency response in the vicinity of what is called as higher 3 dB frequency. We are not going to consider here the lower frequency response, as it is a integrated circuit amplifier. The flat band extends to zero frequency. So in order to find out the higher 3 dB frequency omega H, we will first consider the generalized function. So generalized function is given by AS is equal to AM 1 plus S by omega Z1 into 1 plus S by omega Z2. Such n terms are present. So 1 plus S by omega Zn. These are zeros of the transfer function. These are called the transmission zeros. Omega Z1, omega Z2 are called the transmission zeros. 1 plus S by omega P1, 1 plus S by omega P2. Such n terms are present also in the denominator. So 1 plus S by omega Pn the value. Now we have seen that in practical situations, always the zeros on the high frequency side are either at infinity or they are at a very high value in comparison to the first pole in the circuit, the pole which is close to origin. So because of this, what is going to happen is the terms in the denominator, terms in the numerator, they will be constant. For example, if I take the first 0, 1 plus S by omega Z1, so to understand the effect, I can write this as 1 plus J omega divided by omega Z1. Remember that we are interested in the vicinity of the midband gain. Here the value of omega is smaller than omega Z1, so this complete term is very small as compared to 1, so it can be neglected. So this can be written as simply 1. So same thing is applicable for other zeros. As we have seen, these zeros are far away from origin, so we can write A of S as AM. In the numerator there will be 1. Now in this case, suppose there are multiple poles out of which the one which is at the lowest frequency will be of significance to us. Now in this case I assume that omega P1 is closer to origin than any other pole, and we are going to define formally what is called as a dominant pole. A pole is called dominant if it is 4 times magnitude away from the next pole or zero, that is the nearest pole or zero. Such pole is called as a dominant pole. In this case I am going to assume that omega P1 is a dominant pole, so 1 plus S by omega P1 in the vicinity, because this is going to define the omega H value also, so I will not be neglecting this value. But if I take any other, suppose the next pole which is close to omega P1 is omega P2, but the condition is that, so in case of 1 plus S by omega P2, which can be written as 1 plus J omega upon omega P2. So I am interested in the frequency near the midband gain. So this value is 4 times smaller than omega P2. So this factor becomes less than 1, so can be neglected. So I will write it. So same is the case for omega P2 and other poles in the system. So only pole that is remaining will be 1 plus S by omega P1. Other poles are neglected because they are insignificant in deciding the value of higher 3 dB frequency. So this is the transfer function that we get. This is applicable only when the pole is dominant. So again, omega P1 is a dominant pole only when it has a lowest frequency among all the poles and zeros, and the next pole is at least at a distance of 4 times the location of omega P1. Suppose if I take omega P1 at say 10 megahertz, so next pole should be at least at 40 megahertz, then we can call omega P1 as a dominant pole. Now suppose if this condition is not met, then how to calculate the value of omega H? So in this case, in case of dominant pole, I can write omega H as very close to omega P1, that is higher 3 dB frequency is almost equal to the first pole frequency, dominant pole frequency. This is the approximation. Actually the frequency should be a point where the gain reduces by 3 dB, but we can consider this approximation. Now if the pole is not dominant, in that case how to calculate omega H? So I will use here a direct formula. So derivation, you can see it in any of the book. So it is 1 upon omega P1 square plus 1 upon omega P2 square plus so on minus 2 times 1 by omega z1 square plus 1 by omega z2 square plus so on. So this formula is applicable when the pole is not dominant. By that way we can find out the higher 3 dB frequency or higher cutoff frequency. Okay, now if the pole is dominant, how to find out the frequency? So we have seen one method. So I take just one example here. Suppose we take this circuit. We have solved this circuit with the help of small signal model as well as Miller multiplication method. So in this case I can write, suppose if I apply the Miller's multiplication method. So in that case omega P1, that is a pole on input side, is given by 1 divided by R in equivalent. R in equivalent is nothing but R1 parallel R2 parallel Rin multiplied by CGS plus Rin equivalent multiplied by 1 plus GM Rout into CGD. We know that CGD is a floating capacitance, can be converted into equivalent capacitance on the input side by Miller multiplication. So this is the pole on the input side. Similarly, there is a pole on output side. Omega P2 is given by 1 upon R out multiplied by CGD plus CdB plus CL. Now CGD on the output side, because of Miller multiplication, remains CGD, right? So out of these two, it is difficult to say which one is a dominant pole. So it is difficult to find out which one is a dominant. If CL is absent, then I can say omega P1 is a dominant pole. But in presence of CL, it is very difficult. The reason is CL might be the input capacitance of the next stage. Suppose if I replicate this stage and connect the output of this amplifier to the input of the next amplifier, similar stage. So CL becomes CGS plus CGS of the next stage, that is CGS2 plus Miller multiplication of CGD2. So it will be a quite huge capacitance, we cannot neglect it. So in such case, there is no use of Miller multiplication method. Second thing is, then how to write down the dominant pole frequency or the higher 3 dB frequency? We have seen another method. That method is like, we should see the small signal model, solve it, and then using the approximation of dominant pole. So denominator that comes is a second order S equation. So we have to write this as one. So it is a second order equation. There will be two poles. So 1 upon S by omega P1 into 1 plus S by omega P2, which is equal to S square divided by omega P1 into omega P2 plus 1 by omega P1 plus 1 by omega P2 into S plus 1. Now in such case, if omega P1 is a dominant pole, that is it is close to origin, so 1 by omega P1 becomes large value and we can neglect omega P2. So the coefficient of S will be omega 1 upon omega P1. Using that method, we have found out the expression for omega P previously. So that comes to be equal to, so that omega P1, that is a dominant pole, in such case comes to be equal to R in equivalent multiplied by CGS plus R in equivalent multiplied by 1 plus GM into R out multiplied by CGD plus R out multiplied by CGD plus CDB plus CL. So this will be the dominant pole. Non-dominant pole, multiplier of S square is 1 upon omega P1 into omega P2. So we can find out from this, once we know the coefficient of S square, we can find out omega P2, because omega P1 is already known. So we are not going into details of it. So this will be a dominant pole. Now in this case, whether the pole is heavily dependent on CL or not can be easily calculated. So we have to compare the values of CL and 1 plus GM R out into CGD and the other values of R out and C in equivalent, and then we decide which of the term is important to us. But this method of writing the dominant pole is the complex one. We can use another simplified method to find out the dominant pole by this way. Remember that we are not interested any pole that is lying on this side. We are only interested into a pole which is dominant one. So to find out that dominant pole, because the final aim of a designer is to calculate the higher 3 dB frequency, or find out a method by which you can shift that higher 3 dB frequency away from origin, so the bandwidth of the amplifier will be very large. Ideally, we want infinite bandwidth. So in such case, we can apply another method called as the open circuit time constant method to find out the higher 3 dB frequency of an amplifier. Dual method of this, to find out the lower 3 dB frequency using short circuit time constant method, we have applied it for low frequency response. But before going into the method, we will write the expression for AS, which we have written it here in some other format. So it can be written as A of S is equal to AM multiplied by 1 plus A1 S plus A2 S square plus, such n terms are there. So AN S raised to N. Similarly, in the denominator, there will be 1 plus B1 into S plus B2 into S square plus BN S raised to N. So you can see that denominator, there are n factors or n poles, but out of it, I told you already, the dominant pole is important to us. The coefficient A1, A2, etc. will be decided by the omega Z1, omega Z2, etc., while B1, B2, BN will be decided by omega P1, omega P2, etc. So the value of B1 is given by 1 upon omega P1 plus 1 upon omega P2 plus such n poles. So 1 upon omega PN. Now, this is the exact value of B1. But if omega P1 is dominant, that is close to 0, then 1 upon omega P1 will be very large. We can neglect all other terms, and B1 can be approximately written as 1 upon omega P1. So if omega P1 is a dominant pole, we have defined it already, what is dominant pole. In such case, omega H can approximately be written as omega P1, and omega P1 is approximately equal to 1 upon B1. So if we are able to find out from a circuit the value of constant B1 or the factor B1, we will be able to find out what is the higher 3 dB frequency of an amplifier. Now, in such case, we will apply the method. So there is a formal method available to find out the value of B1. So we will see stepwise the method that is applied. So the steps followed are, the first one is, we should make the input signal 0 to the circuit. So if it is a voltage source, should be short circuited. If it is a current source, it should be open circuited, or signal should be made 0. In second step, one capacitor is taken at a time. Suppose if I call that capacitance as Ci, then by observation or by some calculations, we should find out what is the total resistance seen by Ci, right? And then that resistance, if I call it Ri. Now, when you consider the calculation for capacitance Ci, all other remaining capacitances should be replaced by open circuit. That's why this method is called as open circuit time constant method. So once we have Ci and Ri, Ci is the capacitance, one capacitance from the circuit, replacing other capacitances by open circuit. Ri is the resistance seen by Ci, then the time constant Ti associated with it is given by Ri multiplied by Ci. Okay, so we got the time constant So this process has to be repeated for all the capacitances into a circuit. Only one capacitance should be taken into account. Remaining capacitances should be replaced by open circuit. So in such case, once this procedure is completed, the total time constant, which is represented by TH, is nothing but summation of all time constants TI. Right? Or it is written as summation of I is equal to 1 to n Ri into Ci. And then the value of B1 is given as 1 upon TH, or it is written as 1 upon summation of from I is equal to 1 to n Ri into Ci. So this will give us the value of a B1. Once B1 is known, it is simple to find out omega H. Omega H is given by 1 upon B1. So this method is applied to find out the higher 3 dB frequency. By this method, we will not be able to identify the location of remaining poles, but it is of not use to us, as we are interested only in finding out the frequency near the midband gain, and that is our higher cutoff frequency. Now we will apply this method to the same circuit.